in the last cookies.
Good morning, friends.
It is the last day of April, and tomorrow is May Day. Now, when I was a kid, and when my mom was a kid, going back, May Day was a day to make little baskets and take them around, and you would take them to your friends' houses and to your neighbors' houses, and it was just a really fun way to show people that you appreciated them. It was a way of showing gratitude. So what are you grateful for? When you think about that, what are you grateful for? Grateful means glad that you have, glad you have in your life, glad that's a part of your being. Are you grateful for families? Are you grateful for friends? Are you grateful to have a yard to play in or a park to go to? Are you grateful for your lungs that fill with air so that you can laugh? Are you grateful for eyes to see and a mouth that you taste ice cream? Are you grateful for all of the favorite things that you love to eat? So I'm grateful for all of those things. I'm grateful for long walks and all kinds of fun things that fill my days. I'm grateful for the people in my life that bring me joy and the people that challenge me to be better. So what do we do when we're grateful for something, when we're proud of somebody? Like if somebody came up to you and handed you a big chocolate bar, your favorite chocolate bar. What's your favorite chocolate bar? Okay, so if someone walked up to me and handed me a great big Heath bar, I would say thank you. So saying thank you, that's what we do when we're grateful for something. Small things and big things, we should always say thank you. And all of the things that we love, God made possible. God gave us this amazing world. God gave us seasons and birds and grass and family and friends and apples and legs to run and all of these things because God loves us. And God wants us to be in a world that is beautiful and in a world that makes us happy and a world that is ours to care for. So do you remember every day to thank God? Do you start your day by saying, thank you, God, for another day? Or do you end your day by saying, thank you, God, for my friends or for my family or for the person that I met today? It's so important that we do that. And in the Bible, there is a collection of poems and music called the Book of Psalms. And in the Book of Psalms, there's a lot of them that have to do with gratitude, about taking time to say thank you. So I'm going to share the 100th Psalm. It says, acclaim the Holy One with joy, all the earth. Serve God with gladness. Enter into God's presence with a joyful song. Know that the Most Holy One is God. God made us, and we belong to the Creator. We are God's people and the sheep of God's pasture. Enter God's gates with thanksgiving and the courts with praise. Give thanks to God. Bless God's name, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever, and God's faithfulness for all generations. So remember to say thank you to God. Remember to take time to say a prayer, to say thank you for this day. So I'm going to invite you to say a prayer with me. I want you to repeat after me. So let us pray. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for creating me. Thank you for loving me. Help me every day care for all you created. Amen. Have a great week, friends. Look forward to seeing you soon.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see all of you here today. I have a confession to make. I'm an introvert. I am. I know. Most people are like, what? So on the Myers-Briggs scale, you know, your introverts and extroverts, I'm like right in the middle. And depending on the event, I can kind of swing either way. But I tend to recharge by quiet and by, you know, just kind of downtime, family time. So yesterday, I was blessed to attend the Amos training with lots of people and Friday night. And so my confession is really that I'm tired today. I'm tired. And I know some of you are achy. I know that your bodies aren't acting the way you want them to act. One of the things that I learned is at the Amos training is that in a recent survey, 50% of the U.S. is lonely. Part of it has to do with the decline of the American institution. A lot of those places where we used to go and gather and be community are gone. There are less people attending churches. A lot of civic organizations are also in decline. So people don't have connections, so they're lonely. So I'm grateful for this place to come today, to be with all of you, to combat the loneliness that we feel. And even though I'm tired, I'm glad that I woke up this morning. Yeah, me too. Thank you, Dixie. Thank you. Phew. I'm grateful for the green grass, and I'm grateful that I had a car to get here. I'm grateful that I had a warm bed to sleep in, and I'm grateful that my husband went to Whole Foods and bought me a scone to enjoy this morning. We all, when we're tired and we're aching and things feel kind of rotten and we're maybe even lonely, we still have something to be grateful for. So let us focus on that today. On the things that we have to be grateful for. A church family that is here to love us and inspire us and to challenge us. A warm place to worship where we can have coffee together and share life struggles. A place where we can be reminded every week that we're loved. That we're loved. That we're loved by one another and we're loved by a God who holds us tight when we are tired and holds us softly when we are sore. And walks this journey with us. So praise God.
Good morning. Please join me in the words of awareness. We come to worship with gratitude and joy.
We lift our voices, offering our praise for the gifts of our lives and our world.
We are grateful for those who fill the world with music and art.
And we open our hearts to those who need reminds us of our
blessings. With tenderness and love, we gather.
And with lives full of gratitude, we say,
All right. Good morning, New Beginnings. Our welcoming hymn this morning is Sanctuary. That's the Chalice Praise, the purple book number 49, which you can find there in that book or up on the screen. We're going to sing it through two times. Please stand as you are able in body and or spirit.
Lord, prepare me to sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lord, prepare me to be sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you.
Let us pray. Creator God, your people are so very complicated. We strive to do justice, and yet so many of your children still face inequality, inequity, violence, bigotry, and discrimination every day, and we fall short. We ignore your call for kindness and to care for our neighbor, hiding behind our own fears and arrogance. We're distracted by things that don't really matter while those who struggle continue to fall further behind. We struggle to embrace the humility you call us to embrace, vainly centering ourselves rather than walking alongside you. But in our own complicated nature, we still recognize and seek the promise and hope of your love you share without condition. The promise of hope and love exhibited at a humble table set for all in your world. The promise of hope and love through the good news for all your children to experience. We are grateful for all that you are and all that you have provided, the beauty of the earth and all that inhabit it, the bounty of curiosity and ingenuity throughout history, the gifts of song and word expressed freely, the capacity for love and joy and laughter shared. Gracious and loving God, may we never be satisfied to rest in our own gratitude for all that you have provided, but through our gratitude, may we be strengthened to be instruments of justice every day. May we have the courage to love kindness and show mercy for all the children of your world. May we accept the challenge to walk with humility at your side in all that you ask us to do. O God, may we join with one voice in gratitude. Creator in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
So today we're talking about gratitude, and we're talking about just this idea that we should stop and be thankful for all of these things. So November is Thanksgiving, right? But I'm going to say that I believe that May is the month of gratitude. So we're grateful that spring has come. Well, theoretically anyway. During May, we show gratitude for our mothers and all of the mother figures in our lives. Students and teachers are grateful that the school year is almost over, right, teachers? Oh, yes. I have a few of those that are nodding their heads vigorously. Parents of seniors are grateful that their students have reached the end of one chapter of their lives and are beginning another. And on important days like Mother's Day and graduation, we stop and we remember the people that helped us arrive at that moment. Graduates are grateful for their teachers and their parents for supporting them throughout their schooling. Every single senior graduation speech that I have ever sat through, and I've sat through a few, always, always, always takes time to say thank you to my parents. Thank you to the teachers that challenged me. Thank you to all of these individuals and coaches who have helped that student reach that moment and help them excel and challenge themselves throughout their school career. For the student and for the parent, them also, there's this moment of recognition that this is a huge milestone. And in that moment of graduation, the parent's role changes forever. And the student becomes responsible for their future in a whole new way. As we know, mom and dad are always there, especially those of us who are boomerang parents. But the when and the where that we are parents, how we interact with them once they graduate is forever changed, will never be the same. But of course, no matter how old we get, we still need our moms, right? We still need not only our moms, but those mother figures in our lives. The people who hold us extra tight when they give us a hug. The people who call when we don't show up to church 2 weeks in a row. The people who are there for us when the world is falling apart and we are lonely and we just need to pick up the phone. And so on Mother's Day this month, it's May 14th. It's a day that we celebrate and thank the women that love us, both those that gave birth to us and those who have chose to open their hearts to us. Now, if you were to take a look in the Old Testament, you will find a lot of really bad examples of motherhood. Some of those kings' moms, yikes, the lengths that they would go to make sure that their son was on the throne. Not exactly the greatest examples of motherhood. They had either their son's ambition or their own ambition in mind. And they did some pretty questionable things. And of course, when we think about mothers in the New Testament, we think about Mary. We think about Mary and being a mom. And I wish, I say this often. I really wish that the New Testament gave us a few more glimpses into the child Jesus. You know, what it was like for him growing up. His father Joseph teaching him the tools of the trade. Him going to the synagogue. Him playing with his friends along the river. Him just being and learning. We miss out on all of that. But as Mary is also a wonderful mother example of all she did for Jesus to get him to that moment, hers is also a terrible story of anguish. Cannot imagine what she endured. As those of us who are mothers and mother figures, we cannot imagine what it took for her to watch her son go off into the world and then in the end to face such horrible, horrible, horrible things. But she was a woman of faith. And so I imagine that in her most difficult moments, she would call upon the Torah, that she would go to sacred scripture to find comfort and inspiration. Perhaps she read Psalm 27, 9 through 11. Do not turn your back on me. Do not reject your servant in anger. You've always been my helper. Don't leave me now. Don't abandon me, O God of my salvation. Even if my father and mother abandon me, the Lord will hold me close. Teach me how to live, O Lord. Lead me along the path, for my enemies are waiting for me. Even Jesus, as he was facing some of those horrible events, he ensured that his mother was cared for. And in the Gospel of John, some of Jesus' very last final words from the cross showed just how much he loved her and had concern for her. John 19, 26 through 27 says, when Jesus saw his mother standing there beside the disciple he loved, he said to her, "Dear woman, here is your son." And he said to his disciple, "Here is your mother." And from then on, this disciple took her into his home. You see, Jesus loved and had concern for his mother. And I'm sure that love he had was for her was only surpassed by her love for him. As we know, it is not easy being a parent. Whether you have given birth to a child or simply act as a parental figure in someone else's life, you know that it is hard to be a parent. Fathers and mothers may feel that 1 Peter was written for them. 1 Peter 2. 19 through 21 says, "For God is pleased with you when you do what is right and patiently endure unfair treatment. Of course, you get no credit for being patient if you are beaten for doing wrong. But if you suffer for doing good and endure it patiently, God is pleased with you." Ever felt like that as a parent? "For God has called you to do good, even if it means suffering, just as Christ suffered for you, for he is our example and you must follow in his steps." Sometimes it feels like parenting is all about suffering. But the rewards are good. Every time my son gives me a great big hug for no reason at all the suffering is forgiven. So to follow in Jesus' footsteps means that as parents and parental figures, we love unconditionally. But unconditional love does not remove frustration, and every parent certainly feels tested. See, we want to do our best. We want what's right for our child. We have their future all figured out. If only they would cooperate. But the Bible says that doing right for our children and loving is a two-way street. And that's what Jesus showed us. Just as a parent gives their love and gives their best, well, the Bible says that so too must the children. Deuteronomy 5:16 says, honor your father and mother as the Lord your God commanded you. Then you will live long, a long full life in the land of the Lord your God is giving you. But Leviticus takes it another step forward. Leviticus 29 says, anyone who dishonors father or mother must be put to death. Such a person is guilty of a capital offense. So in May, we give gratitude for all those mothers that haven't taken that literally. We're grateful for the mothers and women who love their children unconditionally, support them tirelessly, and do their best to instill the values of love and kindness into them. Mothers also teach their children to appreciate beauty and care for God's creation. As soon as my kids were old enough, we had them in the garden, planting seeds, punting flowers into the planters, pulling weeds. They didn't like pulling the weeds part near as much as the rest. Picking the vegetables from the garden, helping them understand how it all worked together, teaching them to love the world. Mothers and inspirational women teach children that they are part of God's great cycle of life. They teach about the cycle of seasons, about summer and fall and winter and that mythical thing, spring. Yes, we are finally over winter, at least on the calendar. And this week, I think we're finally going to see the end of the cold temperatures. And for that, I am truly grateful. And so after a long winter, we're very excited about the green. I'm even excited about dandelions, you know? I mean, that's how happy I am that warm weather is here. I like that as the warmer weather comes, the pace of our lives change. We spend more time outside. I personally spend more time walking. I like sitting in my hammock outside reading or having coffee out on the patio in the morning. There's just nothing like spending that time in nature. And so I am grateful that I am given the opportunity to do those things. And of course, now the farmers are all busy. Did anybody grow up on a farm? Not many farms, a few farm families. I didn't grow up on a farm, but I grew up in a farm community at Adel. Lots and lots of farmers in our church. And so we were very aware of the cycle of the seasons because of the farmers' lives. You'd see the farmers in the fields. If you go down any road headed out of town, you're going to start to see all the farmers out there putting their seeds into the ground. Ecclesiastes 11:4-5 say, farmers who wait for perfect weather never plant. If they watch every cloud, they never harvest. Just as you cannot understand the path of the wind or the mystery of a tiny baby growing in its mother's womb, so you cannot understand the activity of God who does all things. So today I watched the trees blowing the trees, and wind was blowing cars and hair and coats and everything else. It's a time to watch seeds growing and to marvel at God's creation, at this amazingly complex and beautiful way that it all fits together. We have so much to be grateful for. We have a relationship with God. We have family, church family, friends, shelter, food, clothing. We have safety and security. We have privilege. So where have you seen God's blessings? Where has God carried you? Where have you felt God blessing you personally? Psalm 57, 9 through 11 said, I will thank you, Lord, among all the people. I will sing your praises among the nations, for your unfailing love is as high as the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the clouds. Be exalted, O God, above the highest heavens. May your glory shine over all the earth. But what about those who don't have things that they, anything that they feel they can be grateful for? Our city and our state have plenty of people who place little value on human life, do not see every life as a miracle. They do not celebrate the diversity of God's creation. They are abusive and manipulative, hateful and arrogant. They are unaware of what true love is. They do not appreciate beauty. They are not grateful for all that God has created. Just grateful for the parts of it that are easy. Grateful for the parts of it that look like them, talk like them, act like them. But God calls us to be grateful for all of creation, to love all people. So if a parent-child relationship is a two-way street, caring for one another, respecting one another, loving one another, and God has given us all of these blessings that we have named today and so many more, the question becomes, how do we love God back? How are we following Jesus' example? How are we showing our gratitude? Now, Acts 2, 44 through 47 said, all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And each day, the Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. I like to imagine myself sitting at one of these tables back in the early beginnings of what we call the church. I like to imagine them coming together and saying, you're cold, here's my coat. You're hungry, here's my food. You have no place to shelter, come home with me. I brought this person with me. I met him on the street and he looked lonely. Can we feed him? Yes. I met this person who was headed out of town with no shoes on his feet and I gave him mine. Do you have any shoes? Yes. That there was this pure gratitude for what they have and this generosity of the blessings that didn't have anything to do with websites or printed flyers or committee meetings or team meetings. It was just about being the grateful people of God. It was a fellowship all about relationships. 1 Thessalonians 2:7 through 8 says, as apostles of Christ, we certainly had the right to make some demands of you, but instead, we were like children among you. And we were like a mother feeding and caring for her own children. We loved you so much that we shared with you not only God's good news, but our own lives too. So May is the month of gratitude. And we're grateful for the changing seasons and for growing things. We're grateful for mothers and mother figures. We're grateful for knowledge gained and milestones of life. And we're grateful for all of the ways that God has blessed this world and us. Now on Mother's Day, we'll show our gratitude with hanging flower baskets, bouquets, taking mom out for a meal, visits and cards and calls. For some of us, we'll visit the cemetery that day. But all of these moms, they'll know that they are appreciated by these simple acts of gratitude and remembrance. We're given the opportunity every day to show God our gratitude for all of our blessings, our everyday prayers of thanks, and our everyday acts of love. They're all a way of showing God how grateful we are. They're like giving God a bouquet of flowers or covering his heavenly refrigerator with handmade cards or her refrigerator. So may we be grateful and remember that every day, in a million ways, we are blessed. And that every day, in a million ways, we have an opportunity to say thank you. Amen.
Our communion hymn this morning is All Are Welcome. We'll sing all three verses.
All are welcome, friends and strangers, at the banquet of the Savior. All welcome, all are welcome here. From the woman who comes crying, leaving tears at Jesus' feet, to the man who knows the right way, but cannot see. All are welcome, friend and stranger, at the banquet of the Savior. All are welcome, all are welcome. From the ones who feel forgotten, those who sense their place is gone, to the ones who live in hunger, here you belong. All are welcome, friend and stranger, at the banquet of the Savior. All are welcome. All are welcome. Go into the streets and cities, to the farms and families, to carve out the splendid table God's mercy. All are welcome, friend and stranger, at the banquet of the Savior. All are welcome, all are welcome here.
A reminder that we have made a change in how we are doing communion. Instead of using only the plastic cups, our primary way of sharing communion is to use these compostable cups. Inside, you'll find a gluten-free cracker and a grape representing the fruit of the vine and our connection to one another. So when the time comes, you will have the option to either use one of these, or we do have a limited number of the prepackaged if you prefer that. So we come to this table full of gratitude, grateful for the opportunity to be a part of something bigger than ourselves, to be part of a mystery that people for 2,000 years have tried to define, to be invited to a table as our whole selves, our brokenness, our loneliness, our mistakes, our sins. All those times that we have not been who we thought God wanted us to be and have held guilt, we let it all go when we come to this table. At this table, it's pure gratitude. Grateful that Jesus walked this earth, that Jesus showed us how to love God, and that Jesus gave us a simple thing so that no matter where we were in the world, how meager what was on our table, that we would be able to remember him. While celebrating the Passover meal, Jesus took the bread upon the table. He blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. Eat this bread and remember my body." At the same meal, Jesus took the cup that was before him. He took that wine and he blessed it and he gave them the cup and he said, "Drink from it, all of you. Drink from this one cup. Be reminded of my blood. I'm reminded that we are one. Every time you drink it, remember me and the covenant that I will not drink it again until I drink it anew with you in the kingdom of God." After they had eaten the meal, they went out and they sang a hymn and went to the Mount of Olives. Let us pray.
Holy and gracious God, we come to this communion table where all are welcome. We pause and reflect on the many blessings we have received. Thank you. Out of our gratitude, we share our money, talents, and time so that we may support this congregation and the larger community. With Jesus as our example, we strive to accept all people and to be good stewards of our world. As we partake of the bread and the fruit of the vine, may our spirits be refreshed, and may this symbolic meal sustain us as we seek to be disciples of Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Repeat after me. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
For the bread of life.
For the bread of life.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
For the cup of hope. Thank you.
Our closing hymn this morning is We Go. You'll find that on the screen and on the handout on a chair nearby to you. We're going to sing it all the way through. Please stand as you are able in body and or in spirit.
We go in the promise of peace. 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 The sun shines on all of the earth. 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 We go in the promise of peace. 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 We go.
On the back of your bulletin, you'll find some notes about things that are happening here at the church and the life of the church over the next week. If you're an elder, please plan on being here on Tuesday evening at 6:30 for the meeting. If you haven't, let Sarah know. If you're joining her for the dinner out at Cool Basil, please do so. A few folks, we still need a few folks to help with the cleanup a week, this coming Saturday, the 6th. And on the 6th is also the day to pick up plants and flowers if you ordered any for the youth sale. If you have donations for the USICS, it's the Immigrant Resettlement Group. We're collecting those on the table the rest of this week and part of next week. They need all kinds of things. Check the Friday email for a complete list of those items that are needed. We're also looking for a flatbed or a trailer to use for the Pride Parade in June. So if you know of somebody that has a flatbed or trailer that we could use, that would be great. Y'all can sit down. I'm going to just keep talking. If you know of anything, or a big boat, another idea would be a big boat. We're going to be walking with folks from Covenant Christian Church, Highland Park, New Beginnings. We're New Beginnings. Downtown Disciples. That's the other one. And then folks from UCC. And so we want to have a way for anybody that wants to be a part of it to be a part of it, even if they can't walk the entire distance. So looking for something to use for the parade. This afternoon from 1 until 4, there is an opportunity to listen to keynote and panelists talking about, can Iowa's water be saved? Iowa faces serious water quality issues due to agriculture waste and runoff. What can we do as Christians and stewards of God's creation? If you're interested in that, it will be at the Plymouth Congregational Church on Ingersoll in the Waveland Room. If you arrive early at 12:15, they will have a lunch available that is made or featuring locally sourced and sustainable food. So I'm plan on going to that if I don't go home and fall asleep. I think those are the big announcements for today. Any other announcements to share with for the good of the cause? No? All right. Very good. Then I invite you to receive the benediction. This comes from 1 Chronicles 16, 34 through 36. Give thanks for the Holy One's goodness. God's love endures forever.
Cry out, save us, God, our Savior, and gather us from among the nations, that we will give thanks to your holy name and glory in your praise. Blessed be, Holy One, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Let all God's people say amen, amen. And alleluia.
Alleluia.
Shalom.